This is a talk about code verification. Our business is developing solvers, isn't it? We'd better check, that is to say, verify that these solvers do their job. As Simon Sinek suggests, let's start with why. Verification usually comes by hand with validation. So, what's the difference? Well, there's a wordplay that comes handy. Verification, are we solving right the equations? Validation, are we solving the right equations? As I said, this talk is about verification. We have to show that the solvers we write solve right the equations. Deal. How do we do that? There is a vast literature about VMV. But to make a long story short, the basic idea is to compare what we get from our numerical computations with exact solutions. Deal. How? Well, the right way to do it is to show that the error, that is to say, the difference between the exact solution and the solution our code gives, tends to zero as the mesh size tends to zero as well. Mathematically, this concept is convergence. There's a nice theorem due to Lax linking convergence to consistency and stability, but that's a different kettle of fish. The main point is that not only do we have to show that it converges, but also that the rate of convergence to zero matches the theoretical value. Wait, what? Imagine a plot of the numerical error in our solver versus the element size h. To keep it simple, let's stick to heat conduction with a finite element formulation. Finite element theory says that the order of convergence of the temperature should be one unit larger than the order of the mesh. That is to say, if we used first order elements such as TET4 or HEX8, the error would have to go to zero as h squared. Second order elements such as TET10, HEX20 or HEX27 should go to zero as h cubed. Does it make sense? I hope it does. Now, let's go back to how. So far, so good. Let's recap and write down a recipe to perform code verification. 1. Solve a PDE with the code you're verifying. 2. Compute a measure of the error with respect to the exact solution. A popular choice here is the L2 error. Repeat for smaller element sizes and record the pair's mesh size and error. 4. Once you have enough data points, make a log-log plot and fit the slope. If it matches the theory, then your code is verified, right? Well, yes and no. Yes, because the error converges to zero with the right rate. But is the range of the element size reasonable? Where's the round of error plateau? Is the error measure well defined? Did we test all the features our solver has? And a long list continues. In principle, we have to test mutually exclusive features only, but comprehensively traversing the list of features might lead to an exponential blowout of combinations to test. Anyway, let's say we somehow managed to sort out all these issues. There's still a deal-breaker caveat. How do you know what the exact solution of the problem is? It seems a chicken and egg situation. If we knew it, we wouldn't be developing numerical solvers, would we? And we need to know the exact solution in order to validate the code of the numerical solver. Enters the method of manufactured solutions, aka MMS, to the rescue. Let's continue sticking to steady-state heat conduction. Given a certain source and boundary conditions, our code's job is to find the temperature distribution. Mathematically, this implies somehow integrating the source Q twice, which is hard. But hey, that's why we have a job in the first place. But we can take the inverse path, start with a known temperature distribution, and find out which source and boundary conditions we need to give rise to that manufactured solution we started from. Mathematically, this means carrying out two derivatives, And derivatives are far easier than integrals. Even more, we can use a symbolic mathematical manipulation tool to do the differentiation for us. Let's see how it works. To keep it simple, let's start with a 2D case first. Let's propose, that is to say, let's manufacture a solution for the problem. Since we are solving a partial differential equation over space in two dimensions, the solution is a function t that depends on both x and y. Say we propose this one. We also need an expression for the conductivity, like this. Then the source we need is this guy. There we go. We'll also need natural boundary conditions, but we're good for now. Let's review what we have to do. Checklist. What do we need? Three things. 1. A solver that can handle algebraic expressions and functions of space. Pick one of the 200-ish solvers we have in the company. We are going to use Onscale's reflex solver. Check. 2. Either calculus skills or, even better, access to a symbolic math manipulation package such as Maxima. A match between the expression syntax of the solver and the math package is a plus. Check. 3. Either a lot of patience to run a parametric loop, or better, some scripting skills, as long as your solver is script friendly. Check. So we are ready to go. Let's rewrite the recipe to validate our code with MMS in 10 steps. 1. Propose a manufactured T and K and write them in Maxima. 2. Compute the source term by applying the differential operator to the expressions above. 3. Optionally, ask Maxima to convert expression to text, just in case you need to create some slides for TechCon. 4. Convert the answer to an ASCII string which we can copy into the solver's input, provided the syntax is the same, of course. 5. Choose a domain and decide which boundaries will have essential conditions and which will have natural conditions. It's easier to start with digit only, so that's what we do for now. That's why we were good before with just the source term. 6. Prepare the input for your solver with the conductivity, the volumetric source, and the boundary conditions. In this case, we are using Onscale's reflex solver, which has a JSON input. We define a thermal power density equal to the expression for the source that Maxima gave. For the boundary conditions, we evaluate the manufactured solution. Remember to give the expression for the material conductivity as well. 7. Loop over element size tending to 0. A. Mesh with mean size h, V. Solve for t. C. Compute the L2 error using the manufactured solution as the exact solution. 8. Plot the logarithm of the error versus the logarithm of the element size to check there are straight lines and no round-off plateaus. 9. Fit the slope. 10. Show off the results to the world. Okay, how does the manufactured temperature distribution look like, you might wonder? Well, it looks something like this. This is what we proposed, those squared sines and cosines. Now, how does the corresponding heat source look like? Well, Maxima says it looks like this. Note that we need negative sources to give rise to the manufactured solution. Remember, verification is about making sure we are solving the equations right. This is a mathematical procedure which need not have any physical meaning whatsoever. So, the basic idea is to refine the mesh. That's easy to do with structured quadrangles. But we also have to test for triangles, and for structured grids as well, and for different element orders and boundary conditions. Recall the exponential blowout? Anyway, all these temperatures look alike for the naked eye, don't they? Yet, the computer can tell there are small differences between the numerical solution our code gives and the exact manufactured solution we proposed. These differences get tinier and tinier, though. And the rate at which these differences get tinier is what we need to verify our code with the method of manufactured solutions. These are some results for the two decays we proposed, as solved by reflex with different meshing algorithms, element types, and orders. These slopes match the theory, although the uncertainties get larger for bad quality meshes. We have lots of results due to exponential blowout, so ping me for more details. Wanna have some fun? Let's go 3D and nonlinear with Neumann boundary conditions. First, let's extend our manufacture solution into the Z dimension. And since we're going wild, let's propose a temperature-dependent conductivity to render the problem nonlinear. Here's the source term we need to have the manufacture expression as the solution of the heat conduction equation. Again, since we're going wild and putting Neumann boundary conditions in some phases, we need the heat fluxes as well. Luckily, Maxima can compute them for us. By the way, I wrote a post in Unscale's blog a couple of years ago. It was linear only at that time, but just in case you want to check it out, here's the link to the post. Anyway, here are the straight lines that show how the solutions obtained by reflex for a nonlinear heat conduction problem with a crazy heat source and half of the boundary of the domain with crazy prescribed heat fluxes converged to the manufacturer solution we proposed with the right theoretical rate. The method of manufacture solutions provides the tax solution we need to compute the error when we decide to embark on the task of verifying our solver. And it does so by going backwards and asking, what is the source needed to get a certain solution? As we showed, it works for both linear and nonlinear problems, although complexities do arise. For instance, mixed formulations need separate convergence studies for each field, and eigen problems like modern analysis need some extra care. Also, coming up with a source involving nonlinear mechanical problems might complicate the mathematics a lot. And for instance, contact is off the table as far as MMS is concerned. Some other things to mind. The mesh size. What's that mean for an unstructured grid? The computation of the error. Take into account that the larger differences are away from the nodes, and we have to integrate the square of that difference to get the L2 error. Make sure you nail it right. The tolerance of the iterative solvers. I know direct solvers are nicer, but sometimes there are jobs that need to involve iterative solvers only. At some point, there will be a competition for sources of errors.